Hey folks, Matt Eaton here, Scholar Gladiatoria. So we've talked a little bit in the past of why some soldiers carried short swords. And of course, that's a very broad question because it applies to a huge period of history. Famously, the Roman legionary carried a short sword, a gladius, but of course that was for a very specific reason because it was used with a very big shield, the scutum. When we get into the, shall we say, the gunpowder era, that's somewhat of a different reason for carrying short swords. And as I've spoken about before, it's largely because they are secondary or backup weapons. So we will, in another episode, look at another type of short sword, but what I've got here is the so-called pioneer's short sword, and you will notice that it has a saw edge. More about that in a second. So this was carried by pioneers. What are pioneers? Well, not necessarily exactly like Davy Crockett, but within a British Army context in the 18th, 19th centuries, and in this case the mid 19th century and right the way through to the 20th century, they are essentially engineers, should we say. They're people who forge ahead, they prepare bridges, prepare paths, clear brush, they clear camps. They do all of this kind of manual labour, basically, but they are also soldiers. They do have guns, they do have bayonets and sidearms, and they are expected to fight. But their primary kind of day-to-day job is a lot of the preparatory work for sieges and for camping and perhaps even for battles and things like gun emplacements and things like that. So quite obviously, these pioneers, because they spend most of their time digging trenches and chopping things down and clearing brush and this kind of stuff, even preparing campfires and that kind of stuff, they need tools. Now you might think, well, why do they have to have a sword that's a tool? Because obviously tools existed and they had tools as well. Yes, they did have things like brush clearing kind of knives, billhooks, things like that. They had axes, they had saws, they had obviously shovels and pickaxes and mattocks and these sort of tools as well for digging trenches and all of that kind of stuff and preparing things like sandbags or gabions and stuff like that. But the fact is that if you're going to give them a sidearm, then you may as well make it a sort of fairly useful sidearm. But also, if it's a sidearm that is principally a weapon, which this is, then it may as well, if possible, have a secondary purpose. So, first of all, these guys, if you imagine, they're carrying a lot of kit around. At any moment, they might have huge amounts of stuff on their back. They might be having mules or donkeys or horses or carts that they're transporting material with as well. Might involve munitions, but usually for pioneers, it would involve things to do with things like sieges or, you know, trench systems or defences or bridges, you know, the transport of the baggage train and the military. So they don't want a cumbersome weapon. And they did have guns. Very often these pioneers would have had things like carbines, perhaps even pistols. Sometimes they would have had rifles and muskets, so long arms as we would call them, but sometimes they carried shorter arms, which is something we also find with artillery gunners as well. So for defence they have to have weapons. Remember, artillery and pioneers and artillery are often related in this period. Artillery are super vulnerable to things like cavalry, so it's no good having a gun which costs lots of money and a crew and horses to pull it, which costs lots of money and are very, very important and very effective on the battlefield, if you can send five guys on horses in and take them and spike the gun or steal the gun, as we saw during the Crimean War that led us ultimately to the charge of the Light Brigade, for example. The Russians took the guns. So you have to be able to defend the guns. Same thing with pioneers, you have to be able to defend a position. So if you imagine a bridge, throughout history, bridges and roads, of course, but bridges have been particularly important. So very often the success of your military campaign is dependent upon the ability of your soldiers to get from one place to another place within a certain amount of time. If they are late, if they are too slow, then you might lose that strategic position and the war might be lost. Okay, so bridges and roads, very, very important. And pioneers were super important in going and making sure that those roads and bridges were passable and serviceable and able to sustain the army with all of its baggage train or perhaps artillery to go along it and over it. And equally, they sometimes had to defend that position. So it was important that these pioneers weren't just workmen, but they were also soldiers, and they were also able to defend that position. So therefore, you give them guns, you give them swords, you give them bayonets, So this is principally a weapon. But as mentioned, you've got a saw edge on the back. Now, was that really necessary? Well, I've asked myself this question. You could have just given them this as a backup. You could have given them a musket with a bayonet on the end. There you go, there's their hand weapon. And then you could have given them the sword that they need. You don't necessarily need to give them a short sword that is both a weapon and a saw. But you know what? We have to be honest with ourselves. Not everything has a utilitarian purpose. And in a sense, some things are given to certain types of soldiers because of preconceptions about how those soldiers operate, or indeed because it's kind of like a badge of office. You look at someone wearing one of these and you're like, ah, it's the pioneers. I know who that is. So I think these fulfill several functions. Yes, they are a weapon. Potentially they're a tool. How often did these saws get used? I don't honestly know. If we're frank about it, these don't seem to be very heavily used, these saw edges. I've never seen a saw edge on one of these that actually looks like it's been used much. And we have to be honest that these very often are really a badge of office. But that's not to say that these didn't get used. These weren't only things that they just wore at their side to show I am a pioneer. These were indeed sometimes used as weapons. I can't say whether they were used as tools, although I'll come back to that point in a minute. These were definitely used as weapons because I know of at least one and maybe two accounts of Royal Engineers pioneers using these sawback swords in combat. The most well-documented, or should we say clearly documented example is from, I know I use this often because it's something I study a lot, but the Indian Mutiny, there is an account of a pioneer using one of these to kill an opponent. But bizarrely, the person writing the account notes that they used the saw edge. Why they use the saw edge, I don't know, I couldn't say. These are pretty pointy, and I'll come to how I would use this as a weapon in a second. But additionally, as a tool, you can use these for chopping up wood or clearing brush. Now, I'm not saying that that's perhaps what they normally used. I suspect they normally used the tools that they carried. But bear in mind, if you're wearing this all the time, then it is going to get used for jobs like that. If you make a comparison today, a soldier deploying to Afghanistan or Iraq or wherever in the world, is going to have a knife or a bayonet on them. Now, that knife or bayonet, for the most part, there are exceptions, is not going to get used as a weapon. But it is almost certainly going to get used as a tool. And very, very often under my videos talking about bayonets, I have veterans of previous campaigns, both in Europe and Middle East and elsewhere, who say, yep, we used our bayonets or we used our knives, fighting knives, for things like opening tin cans or opening boxes, cutting string, cutting rope, all sorts of jobs. So very, very important to actually have a cutting implement. And remember, this is from this weapon, this is a day and age in which there was still a very real possibility that if you were in a small group, you could be jumped, you could be attacked by a group of people who might be armed with swords, bayonets, maybe even spears, whatever. Or even wild animals, that's the other thing to point out. So certainly for the British Army, in the areas of the world where the British Army deployed, wild animals were a thing as well. You literally might be attacked by, whatever, lions or potentially things like leopards or hyenas or all sorts of stuff, okay? It was possible, unlikely, but possible. Okay, so a self-defense implement that is also an edged weapon, useful thing, and you have it with you all the time. It is a sidearm. So whereas, if you're out in the brush doing one job and you realize that you need to split some wood, the job you're doing doesn't involve having that tool with you. So you're like, well, I've got this. So you'd use this. Now, we do also know that these short swords were used, or similar short swords, should we say, not exactly the same as this, but short swords nevertheless in the same period, were used by artillery gunners, and they were used as tools because it is noted that these weapons, as some people saw them, were never really used as well, or very rarely used as weapons, but they were very often used for clearing brush, chopping up wood, firewood, and all that kind of stuff. So absolutely useful tool, useful weapon. Was the saw edge used very often? Probably not. Now, let's look at this as a weapon. Is it a useful weapon? Well, basically, it's a cutlass, isn't it? And we know that when these were decommissioned in the British military, some of them had the saw edge ground off, and they were given to naval ships. So they were occasionally used as cutlasses. And how is it as a weapon? Well, actually, it's great. It handles well, it moves quickly, it's very solidly made. It has the so-called patent tang. So you'll notice that it has a full width tang and you know, solid brass grip riveted on there. So very, very sturdy thing. And it's a good weight, it's a good length, well sharpened, of course. It's going to be useful as a sidearm. And really, the only disadvantage it's got against something like a naval cutlass is that you've only got a simple knuckle bow instead of the kind of big shell guard. But of course, that is for ease of carriage, ease of wearing, and it makes the weapon overall somewhat lighter. So actually, pretty nice sidearm. It's got a very good tip. It's got quite a lot of cutting potential. How was it used? Well, we know that these were used the same as a cutlass, and cutlasses were used pretty much the same as an infantry officer's sabre. So if you look at any of the sabre manuals, any of the sabre systems, so predominantly in British circles used fencing from either terse or high second, usually with cutlasses from high second, these would be used like this. The hand's slightly more vulnerable, so you have to be wary of that, and if people target your hands, you pull the hands away. But remember, there's an opportunity in everything, and if the hand is targeted and you pull the hand away, you've always got the ability to come back with a more powerful blow, because in pulling the hand away, it charges up the arm for a more powerful cut. So pretty good sidearms as well. Again, come back to the point, were they used very often in warfare at this time? No, not very much, but they probably were used sometimes. In fact, we know that they were used sometimes because it's documented. So there we go, the 1856 Pioneer's Sword, British Army Pioneer's Sword, used predominantly by the Royal Engineers, but probably distributed through other individual pioneers or groups of pioneers within other regiments in the British Army. This one is marked 1883. And it does have regimental markings on it. I think it's probably for a volunteer battalion. So even the volunteer forces, who were essentially like the territorial army or reserve, did have these. Really nice things. If you find one of these, if you find one with a scabbard, they normally don't have the scabbards with them. Don't know why, probably because the scabbards were leather. Maybe a lot of them perished, or they were stored separately from the scabbards and the scabbards got disposed of. Don't know. But if you find one of these, pick one up. They're nice. Nice things, and really quite handy. They've got a nice feel to them, and I'm rather fond of these. Anyway, thanks for watching the video. Give us a like and a subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you really soon for another video on Scholar Gladiatoria channel. Cheers for watching. Thanks for watching. We've got extra videos on Patreon. Please give our Facebook a like and subscribe if you haven't already. Cheers, folks.